more interesting in this session today. We are going to discuss about the accessory glands which help small intestine perform its function. In the last session, we already discussed about an accessory gland, that is liver, which helps small intestine. Now we are going to discuss about the another important accessory gland, that is pancreas. Okay, so please make a note of this. Pancreas is a second accessory gland which is important for the small intestine to perform its function. It is said that pancreas is a leaf stray structure present below your stomach. Okay, so if you see the location of the pancreas, this is your esophagus. Here you have a J-shaped organ, that is stomach, and below the stomach you have a leaf shaped structure. Okay, this is your stomach and you have this leaf shaped structure. This leaf shaped structure is known as pancreas. This pancreas is said to be exocrine as well as endocrine gland. Okay, this is a very important information again. Exocrine as well as endocrine gland. Exocrine means basically it can release its secretion into ducts, into pipe-like structure which are known as ducts, as well as it can act as an endocrine gland by releasing its secretions directly into the blood. Okay, so it is an exocrine as well as endocrine. For a small intestine or for the function of digestion, it works as an exocrine gland because it has a pancreatic duct. It has a tube-like structure which connects to the small intestine, and through that tube-like structure, it secretes its chemical secretion or its juice into the small intestine. Okay, so for digestion, it works as an exocrine gland, and to control different hormones in our body, it works as an endocrine gland, or it releases some hormones which controls the amount of chemicals in our body. That time it works as an endocrine gland. Okay, now it is said that the secretions in pancreas is alkaline. Okay, it is already alkaline, so this plus bile juice. So, pancreatic secretion will make the medium and small intestine alkaline. Okay, small intestine. Medium will become alkaline because of those two secretions. Now, pancreas has three important enzymes. Okay, as you see in this picture, it has three important enzymes which helps in breakdown of complex substances. So, the first enzyme is known as proteases. You have a specific protease which is known as trypsin. Okay, what as we studied earlier or discussed earlier, what are enzymes? They are biological scissors, breaking down complex substances into simple substances. Here we have a complex substance that is protein, and it has to be broken down into simple substance, that is amino acid. So it is broken down in small intestine, but the breakdown takes place with the help of an enzyme trypsin, and this trypsin comes from pancreas. Am I clear? From the pancreas, there will be a juice secreted, and this juice will go to small intestine. What is this juice containing? This juice is containing one important enzyme, that is trypsin. What will the trypsin do? Convert proteins into amino acids. That is the simplest compound. Then it has another important enzyme which is known as amylase, which will digest starch and convert it into maltose. So starch is a kind or a name of a specific carbohydrate. So starch will be converted into maltose by an enzyme amylase. And you have one important enzyme, that is lipase. So lipase will act on the small balls made by bile. Okay, you remember emulsification of fat? That was done by bile. So the large fat globule was converted into small globules. Now who will break this small flat globules? So the small fat globules will be broken down by lipase, and it will break it down into fatty acids plus glycerol. These are all the simple compounds: fatty acids, glycerol, maltose, amino acids, etc. These are the simplest compounds that can be absorbed by the blood. Okay, hence this complete digestion takes place in small intestine, but pancreas release some juice and liver release some juice, with the help of which this breakdown can happen or this digestion can happen. Okay, finally, what will happen in small intestine? The breakdown or the digestion will take place, and then absorption will take place. So it is said that in duodenum, maximum is digestion takes place and some absorption also takes place, whereas in jejunum, maximum absorption takes place, and ileum, some absorption takes place, like vitamin B12. Okay, now what is so special in small intestine which helps this absorption of simple substances? What simple substances are formed here? The first simple substance formed here is amino acid. The second simple substance is maltose, which is further broken down into glucose. Okay, this is the simplest compound which can be observed. It is broken down by an enzyme, maltase. This is present in small intestine. Okay, starch will be broken down into maltase by amylase. But maltase has to be further broken down into simplest compound, that is glucose, and that will be broken down by maltase. So this is the second simple compound which is there with us. You have the third simple compound, that is fatty acids and glycerol. These are the simple compounds that has to be sent to each and every part of our body. How it will be sent to each and every part of our body? It will be absorbed, that is a third step of human digestive system, absorbed by the walls of small intestine or from the walls of small intestine by the blood, and then blood will take it to all parts of your body. How? Why is that absorption takes place only in small intestine? So it is said that this walls of small intestine, now suppose this is your small intestine, okay, just a rough diagram. This is your small intestine walls. These are the individual cells in it. Right? This is a nucleus which I am drawing. Okay? And it is said that in the lumen, lumen means the inside part of small intestine. This is the outside and this is the inside. So inside part of small intestine, the hole, where all the absorbed materials are present, like you will have glucose, you will have amino acids, you will have fatty acids. These are present in small intestine. This has to be sent to all parts of your body. So what happens in this walls, in the cells of the small intestine, or in the walls of the cells of the small intestine, you have numerous hair-like structures. You can see this is a lumen and this has hair-like structures. This hair-like structures, which are present everywhere inside the small intestine or on the cells of the small intestine, are known as villi. Okay, these are continuously moving up and down, and because they move, what happens? They increase the absorption of the glucose and amino acids and fatty acids. So what happens? Because of this villi, there is an increase in absorption, and because of the increased absorption, here you have blood vessels. So all that is absorbed will go into this blood vessels, and then this blood will go to all parts of your body. Okay, so what happens? Why there is maximum absorption in small intestine? Because the walls of the cells of the small intestine are covered with numerous finger-like structures. And these finger-like structures are known as villi. And attached to this villi, you have network of blood vessels, many blood vessels attached. So once the villi absorb the glucose, fatty acids and amino acids, they are being transferred to blood vessels, that is arteries, veins, capillaries, and then they will transport to all parts of your body. Okay, so that was all about absorption. We go to the next part, that is assimilation. Okay, so assimilation is basically the next step in human digestion or human nutrition, you can say. What happens in assimilation? In assimilation, whatever simple substances are there, like glucose, then amino acids, fatty acids, etc., are taken by the cells. Okay, once the blood comes to the cell, cell will take them. Suppose you have ordered something from a supermarket, the delivery boy will come and you will take the material from the delivery boy. And what are you going to do with that material? You are going to use it, right? In the same way, the delivery boy here is blood. And once all cells are there. So once the blood gives the substances to the cells use them. And this procedure or this usage of this simple compounds is said to be assimilation. Assimilation means using all this. Okay, so assimilation, what happens? It takes place inside each and every cell of our body, where the simple substances are being used to carry out various life activities. Okay, assimilation takes in every cell. And what happens here? Simple substances are used to carry out various life activities. One such example here is respiration. So you respire. Why? Once you have glucose, once you respire oxygen, you take in oxygen in your body, that oxygen is being used to break down glucose, and then glucose will be converted into carbon dioxide, water and energy, and this energy can be used by you for walking, cooking, running, etc. Okay, so what is glucose doing? Glucose is producing energy. It is giving you energy in the presence of oxygen. So that is one example of assimilation being carried out by each and every cell. What is amino acid doing in your cell? Amino acid is helping in making some important proteins which are required by our body. Or suppose you fall down, right? After that, if you see after 10 to 15 days, the skin again is back to normal. So why is that? Because it is the proteins are making the cells again, right? So that is a repair of worn out tissues. That is because of the amino acid which is present in the cell. And what is fatty acids and glycerol doing? It is synthesizing fats or making fats so that it can be stored in your body. And whenever you don't have much of energy, this stored form of energy can be, or that fats can be used to give you lot of energy. Okay, so assimilation is what? Basically, whatever simple substances are formed by digestion and brought to each and every cell, how the cell is using to gain energy, to make cells, to make skin, or to make a storage form of energy, all this process is known as assimilation. Okay, thank you.